Thank you for coming back in here. Really appreciate it. I got a frog stuck in my throat, so I might have to drink more coffee than I normally drink. It's really a lot. So forgive me if I have to do that. It really is an honor and privilege to be here and talk about this. Very important to me, and it must be very important to you. You're here, you're interested. There's been good questions and good feedback that has come towards me, and I think we're on the same page in a lot of ways. I think it'd be useful for me to kind of, because there are people who weren't here last week, maybe didn't see the recording, to kind of repeat how I came into this. Because I'm not a family counselor, per se. That's not my specialty, exactly. My specialty or my passion is Christian apologetics, it's the defense of the Christian faith. So I have that passage from 1 Peter going up. And it's my realization in the course of my ministry of defending the faith that, first of all, many of the people that I interacted with used to be Christians out of the church. And then, secondly, that, well, hey, a lot of times they come out of broken families as well. Which means that it doesn't matter how strong of an argument I make, there is some baggage, some attitudes that are out of my reach. And those attitudes were entrenched long before I met them. So in a way, my apologetics ministry changed and shifted as I realized that if I really wanted to see the faith transmitted to the next generation, I needed to go to the church and tell them what I was seeing. So that 20 years from now, other people doing the same kind of work don't have the same kind of problem. And to just give you an idea, this is a refresher from last week. The other one. Looked like the green one.
This one?
No, the actual the chart, it's got like a... There we go, that's the one. Now, this is something that puts in numbers, but I think many people already have seen. You detect this, you get the idea just from observing culture. So this is the... did that change that question? Don't do that. Okay, all right. So this is the religiously unaffiliated, people who the pollsters say, what religion are you? And they say, I don't have one. I have none, unaffiliated, that sort of thing. And you can see, as a share of the American population, that it stays more or less the same to right around 1992, and then for some particular reason, it just started going up and up and up and up. So each percentage point represents about 2 million people or so. So we've gone from 6% of the population in 1990, America was about 250 million. You know, do the math, we're at like, 360 now. And now it's almost 25 to 30% of the population. So last week, it was like the stakes. You know, what is it we're grappling with? Every one of these persons is at risk of not having, sharing the eternal hope that we know so much about, we want to share. So the stakes are the people we want to see with us, in heaven with us. And the trend is not going in our favor. So tracking this back, last week, I proposed that the best explanation for this was that these are the children of people who grew up, were born after and in the sexual revolution, and now they are coming of age, making their own decisions, and they are acting on these entrenched attitudes that I referred to before. So I'm not going to go over and defend all that again and explain it all right now, but that brings you up to speed with where we're at today. So I want to begin with understanding what I mean by the attack and why it's important here. Every now and then I have the opportunity when I see my kids coming up the driveway and they get to the front door And I see this happening. So what I'll do is I'll crouch behind the door and I'll put my shoulder against it so they can't see that I'm there. And then I'll just sort of watch them mess with the door. I take pleasure in this. Probably in a wrong way, but there's a joy in it. And that's kind of what we're up against in terms of like the marriage issue or the family issue. You know, what we're enduring and encountering right now, it's not all accidental. Some of it is. It's not just the way the culture happened to go. There was somebody else, there are other people. There was a demonic foe on the other side of the door, trying to make sure they were not seen, and they had their shoulder against it, making it harder to open that door. And so, if they knew that I was at the door, of course they would behave entirely differently, right? They would go around, I think. But if they don't know, then they're just going to keep slamming themselves against the door over and over again, because they can't quite figure it out. And that's our challenge. That's why the second week is on the attack. It's very important that you understand, not all the details of the attack, but some of the specifics. And I'm trying to raise the awareness of at least a few particulars so that you can begin sort of increasing your range of vision and start piecing together some of the things that have happened in our society in the last 40 or 50 years. Because the ultimate goal is to get to next week, we talk about some more practical applications, some more concrete ideas on what we can do once we know that we're up against something. All right? Looks like everyone's with me. Laying it out pretty well. So, if I say so myself, but they might be loved. I didn't mean to come out that way. I should also mention, I'm very glad for that. Oops. So, I wanted to give you a few particulars. In last week, I mentioned no-fault divorce in particular. I think the whole breakup of the family that happened in the 60s and 70s, in the preceding of the 80s, you know, all of it sort of combined to, you know, what it is. I mean, I'm not going to say, you know, it was this, absolutely. Certainly not in every case, with exceptions all over the place. All over the place. But the thing about looking at no-fault divorce is that we can track the implementation of that all the way back to an organization that began right around 1920. There's a gentleman, if you want to look this up, if you want to write this down, if you want more information about this, Dr. Ryan McPherson, out of Bethany Lutheran in Minnesota, has really nailed this down very well. And that group is called the American Law Institute. Now, the American Law Institute were made up of people who did not think American society was built in the way that they approved. It was too rigid, it was too dogmatic, there was way too many religious people around. There was a lot of people who firmly believed that you needed many more controls on the economic system. So, you know, they were communist sympathizers, some of them. Not all of them. Some of them had a deep hatred of communism, too. This is the 1920s we're talking about. But the conclusion that they drew, this is the troubling part. The conclusion that they drew was they could do nothing while the traditional family remained intact. They could do nothing without that. Just think about what the traditional nuclear family is. It's kind of an entity unto itself. If it has a need, someone in the family will provide it. They needed people to need them. This is very important to them in order for them to get the system to work, and everyone had to be involved. So you can read their writings of these people. There's famous people in there. Oliver Wendell Holmes, Supreme Court Justice, Chief Justice. Just gives you an idea of the caliber of people that I'm talking about here. So here's what they did. American Law Institute. These are a bunch of legal, lawyerly type scholars, and they began crafting what are called model laws. So I hope there's no legislative in here. But if there are, please forgive me in advance. I'm sure this is not by me. Legislators tend to be slightly on the lazy side when it comes to crafting legislation. They love it if someone just gives them a piece of legislation and says, all of the experts have looked at this, and they think it's awesome. It's the best thing since sliced bread. And the legislator says, oh, yes, fully formed, already been vetted, the experts approved, put up the cover galore, seems to do an idea to me, and then they implement it. And so the ALI began generating these model laws, and one of the first ones of interest for our purpose was that a reform of the penal system, which was first passed in 1967, I believe, by Ronald Reagan, which provided government-funded abortions for those in the prison system. And that little nook and cranny, just that little bit, this idea of government funding abortions was smuggled in through this model law. California passed it, and then like a wave, each state sort of like, hey, you know, we got this new model law, so it's a good idea. And the setting for Roe v. Wade was set from the point of view of precedent. And then they produced the model law for no-fault divorce. And they had reasons that some of us would say, you know, that's all right. But if you read what they wrote for the 30 years before that, you see that they had those reasons, but other reasons too. They did not have the same high view of the family that comes with the Christian worldview. And so, again, Ronald Reagan, 1970, passed the first no-fault divorce law in California. By about 1980, almost every state of the union had this law. So, I don't know if you can think of any comparable Christian movement going back to 1920 that was fighting to sustain the family. And I think that's probably because that's not the way we operate. It's not the way we think. We don't like the idea of thinking that, well, this person, you know, has an agenda. What I'm trying to get across to you here is that there are people with that agenda. And even before many of us were born, set the wheels in motion. So, with just that kind of foundation laid for what I'm trying to communicate this time, question and answer time, okay? With the other room. It's over there.
Any questions from the group? That's right. We're not going to belabor this, but let's continue on.
Okay. All right. Well, I didn't see that. All right. That's okay. So to give you another illustration of the extent of thought that went into the movers and takers from, say, 1940 to 1980 or so, you have a handout. You can pull it up to there for me. Yeah. So the Jaffa memo, as it's called. So some context. Just give you some context. During the late 1960s and early 1970s. Sexual revolution was in full fire, and there was a lot of pressure at the federal level to implement family planning programs for a variety of reasons, ostensibly to help the poor, a lot of people too, with the idea of there's just too many people. So actually, I didn't bring all my books this time. I was a little short on space. I'll have them all next week. Anyway, so here's one called breeding ourselves to death. Breeding ourselves to death. By a gentleman by the name of Lawrence Later. Who knows who Lawrence Later is? Anyone? You want to know who this person is? He was cited multiple times approvingly by the Supreme Court in the Roe v. Wade decision. So this is a big guy. This is a big mover and shaker. This is a guy who provided the intellectual ammunition. And he believed that the problem in America was we were breeding ourselves to death. Lots of disturbing things in this book. All right. As another example, Paul Ehrlich in The Population Bomb. I know some of you have heard about that. You've lived through that, right? So this memo is by Frederick Jaffa, who was the vice president of the Population Division of Planned Parenthood. And he's writing to Bernard Berelson, who is president of the Population Council. And Berelson said, you know, hey, Fred, I've got this in with the Nixon White House here. And we have to get some real traction. Give us some ideas on what we can do to control, manage, and reduce the population of the United States. And, Frederick Jaffa was in this, this whole line of thought. So he went through all of the research that was available to him, and he shot over this memo. Now, if you look at the memo, the first thing that you see on the left side as an idea is what? Restructure the family. Could I get a copy? I know it's on a memo, but I want to be able to kind of like point to where they are in the column and stuff. Now, I'm not trying to make the case that they implemented all of these. It doesn't really work that way. What I'm trying to get across to you is that from people with this mindset, everything is on the table for consideration. Everything. They don't mind putting into place policies that will want to try to postpone or avoid marriage. What do you think? Are people getting married later these days? They didn't necessarily get their way when they wanted to alter the ideal image of the family size, which is what? Is it bigger or lower now? Lower. I'm not saying that they really wanted to make education compulsory or encourage increased homosexuality, but it kind of starts to smell a little fishy, right? So then you start looking at the other columns, the thing that they're willing to consider. Discouragement of private home ownership. This is in the third column. Housing policies. Now, what on earth do you think discouraging private home ownership has to do with managing the population, reducing the size, restructuring the family? What do you think? I'm forcing you. You must say something now. Oh, are you loud? Here. Wait, I bet you this one. That's good.
Basically, you can only fit so many kids in an apartment. If you have your own home, you can fit as many kids, dogs, as you want.
That's right.
In an apartment, you can only have two people per bedroom.
You can, or as many as the landlord will allow you. When you eventually pay off the house, right, you have that economic liberty, right? With an apartment, you never pay it off. That's good. So she got the right. Oh, here we go over here. Oh, you run. I'm no fool.
Let's find this again. All on one side and all on the other side. All right, with the hand.
Well, in order to control the population, they would like people to move into the cities, so it's easier to control.
Yeah, that's actually true. I can show you actual papers that they wrote in the 60s that I used for that. Well, actually, I'm not as conversant with Frederick Jaffa, but I've been collecting the research articles that they used for consulting these things. And at the very bottom, you see there's a website, jaffamemo.com. I actually have been trying to link to all of the original source materials that Jaffa himself used, so people can kind of get an idea. Well, the one thing that I'll say is about this, because not everything on here, of course, actually made it into official policy. But they had determined that they had a problem that couldn't be solved in the conventional way. In other words, if they realized if they didn't get people to do something and have them think it was their own idea, there would always be resistance. So by the time the early 80s came about, they'd kind of given up on some of these ideas like putting fertility control in the water supply, or the far right third column, compulsory abortion. This is Planned Parenthood, right? They're all about pro-choice, women's choice. No. It's all on the table. Everything's on the table, even compulsory abortion, bless their hearts. But they realized that the compulsory part of it wasn't going to work. And this leads to what I'm trying to get at here. They changed tactics, and they attacked attitudes. They began producing movies and media and giving grants to organizations that would try to impact and affect the culture itself that people were being raised up in. And this has continued, this has persisted. I have a couple more examples here. Just surveying the age group here. More recently, year 2000, a book I acquired, Queering Elementary Education, Advancing the Dialogue of Sexualities in Schooling. So these are a bunch of education consultants talking about how to implement the homosexual agenda within the elementary school system through curriculum and other ways. So I don't know what you were doing in 2000, but I bet you weren't sitting in a big conference room conspiring on how to totally eradicate the culture and get it to be more Christian. It's just not the way we operate. Another example. This was called After the Ball, How America Will Conquer Fear and Hatred of Gays in the 1990s. And it's a strategy paper. It's basically, it even includes a bunch of proposed media advertisements and movie ideas. This would be during the mid-1990s. So, you know, you look out at culture right now, and you look at this fracturing along the lines of sexual identity, and you think, how do we ever get to be a society so quickly, so fast, that could be opposed to gay marriage? Now it's the law of the land, and there's hardly, we have a lot of things. We have marriage amendments, and we have things going our way, as it were. But then the Supreme Court reversed all that. There were no riots in the street. There's still no riots in the street. Because, to go back to our previous chart, 30% of America's population now is okay with it. How did they get there? Why is it that way? What I'm trying to get across to you here is that there are reasons for it. And some of them were deliberately thought about, deliberately implemented across all of culture and media. So if we talk about, okay, yes, we want to strengthen the family, we understand the family's connection to transmitting the faith to the next generation, you have to realize that when you step into that battle, it is battle, that there will be forces on the other side actually fighting back beyond just mere circumstance. It's hard enough. My wife in the room. It's hard enough if everything's perfect. It's just the two of you to get two people to agree on values. The value with money management. You know, I'm talking about the logistics of actually getting two people to agree on anything. Very difficult. Constant conflict. Right? I'm sorry. That's hard. And now you throw in the fact that maybe our attitudes about homeownership didn't just come from ourselves, but were sort of facilitated by people who don't want you to have very many kids. One person wants to have one kid, one person wants to have four. Well, why? Well, there might be some bad news there. You don't even know about in either case. Now, the scriptures say, in 1 Thessalonians 5, test everything. Test everything. Everything's on the table in that passage. And it says, hold on to the good. In 2 Corinthians, it says, take every thought captive for Christ. Every thought. Everything you bring into obedience to the Christian worldview. If you have the most perfect family in the world, that's not what's going to save you. Okay? We're not talking about we're gonna save, actually usher people's souls past the pearly gates because we got family right in a sense. That's not the way it works, and the Bible's very clear that's not the way it works. But what is clear is that God had a plan for how he wanted the earth to be and our place on it. And when we are consistent with that plan, things are just right for the transmission of the Christian faith, of godliness to the next generation. Last week I mentioned in Malachi where it says God made the two one and why in order that there may be godly offspring. Part of the plan. So my goal in this part of it is just to make it clear that there is really no attitude or value that you have that you should not be evaluating and bringing under a Christian worldview, a well-thought-out Christian worldview. And you can see, obviously, how that's going to tie very well into my passion for Christian apologetics. It's not so far off after all. Okay, so surely there must be some more questions and comments. Back out.
I wish I could cite the author of this. After the Vietnam War ended, the revolutionaries of the American society were depressed because now they had nothing to fight against, right? And so, and maybe you've heard this or maybe not, but so that the next frontier they decided was our American colonies, and to take the attack to they needed that groundswelling. Right? And so, I don't know if you've ever had any, come across any research of those who started that, because the timing of the Joffrey memo seems like it's about pretty close to the end of the Vietnam War.
Yeah, last week I brought some of my reading material, my light reading, and some of those people were on there. Kathy Mollick, I think, had a book called Sexual Politics that. This is as an example. The idea that the root problem of American society was men, basically. And all the women are like, wow. Yeah. Well, you know, but it was patriarchy. And that idea then got caught up and incorporated into the just general curriculum. That is not something that I've investigated deliberately, but I could pull together lots of people talking in those terms. I would say, especially by the late 1970s, they had realized that attitude formation was the only thing that they really had going for them, except for actually like lining people up and shooting them. Okay, so they don't want to do that. So that means the education system. That's what's open to them.
It goes along with this proliferation that we have now that everybody has to go to college.
Yeah.
And they've driven that home. Through all the research that you've gone through, have you learned about those who were fighting against this, who kind of saw this happening, and what they did and didn't do right in that fight?
Sure. If you go back to, I mentioned G.K. Chesterton last week, pretty sure. He has a book about 1922 called Eugenics and Other Evils. And in that, he saw that this idea of a population management, herd management, they kind of see us as a herd. Okay? Sometimes you have to pull the herd, and then they stop talking like that after World War II. It didn't go very well. So G.K. Chesterton saw not only the control of fertility and family, but also how they would also begin looking at economic things, like, you know, can people afford their houses? How are they going to live? Where are they going to get their food? And he saw that all of these things were coming under social control by you know, everything we take for granted. Food, education, health, wealth, everything. So he saw the beginnings of that. And then C.S. Lewis in The Abolition of Man saw it pretty clearly. And then finally, perhaps the most current recent expression is Francis Schaeffer's book, How Shall We Then Live? I think I got it. Pretty close to that. And they all tried to warn. And the problem is very basic. It's very foundational. If you believe that this earth will eventually be disintegrated by fire, then as much as you want to try to make the earth better, there are limits to how far you will go. But if you think that the earth is all there is, and this life is all you've got, and if you don't make it perfect right now, then that's where you orient your life, to making it as perfect as possible. And so we are not geared towards trying to iron out every little wrinkle in society in the same way that they are. It's really all they have left. Last week we had a conversation about happiness and joy. Is that gentleman here today? Yeah. So this ties in very, actually kind of right into that. Because if you strip all that away, too, there's really no moral code. And the only thing that they have left is for like whether something is right or wrong is whether or not it makes you happy or creates suffering. So everything gets put on that scale. And that may not seem like very much as you sit here, but as someone who's also very interested and involved in the pro-life debate myself, with my daughter, I go to the state legislature, you know, having conversations. There are a lot of times where like euthanasia will be coming up again here soon. It always does at the beginning of the session. That's something that we want to implement here in our state. And the argument is, well, you know, you don't want to bring people into the world, keep people in the world if they're not going to be happy. They're going to suffer. That's all they have left. So when you begin to understand that the difference between us is so fundamental that they are forced by their worldview to be fully invested in this world in a way that we are not, you'll see why we were not equipped to match them as they began to really put these things in motion. It's just not the way we think. We still don't think that way. Just part of my having this session. It's a great question. Right here.
I guess it's kind of funny at the timing and the dates that you show with the research. How or what is your thought on how such a, I guess looking at the data, blatantly communist or socialistic view could pass into policy in an era that was so coming off of Vietnam and some of the other tensions in history, so anti-communist and so against what is currently the Chinese policy?
How much time do I have? Yeah, there's no quick answer to that. Bill Ayers, and some of you probably know, went underground through a bunch of things and is now a professor at University of Chicago. It reflects that change of what I meant, and they realized that they could not force Americans to come to their viewpoints, so they switched to attitudes. And our challenge in that regard is that, you know, attitudes that is part and parcel of what the Christian worldview is kind of about in many ways. Not viewing the world in a worldly sort of way, but viewing any person that we meet as someone who's going to live forever, either in an eternal paradise or the other place. You know, that's how we view people. It's not how they view people. And right now, they're kind of winning that in subtle ways that we have to awaken ourselves to. And I'm sorry to say, the education system is just filled with this, and I don't really have the time to defend my statement, which makes me feel awkward. Okay, so now we're heading to three minutes? Help me out. 15, even better. Okay, so I do want to make clear that I'm not saying that, you know, all these things were done. I'm just trying to make clear that these are the kinds of things that are on the table, and they are all encompassing. Your entire life is potentially wrapped up in the kind of thinking that they have. And when we think about families and what helps them be strong versus what can tend to fracture them, I want us to broaden our horizon in a similar way. Because if you kind of, there is a doctrinal element to it, in the sense that, yes, we know that God said He made man and woman to be one flesh, all that. We know that. But sometimes, what we take as a doctrine, we don't always act as if it's actually like real. Like, oh, that's just our opinion. And I'm trying to tell you, these things are actually part of God's plan, and His plan is real. This stuff is true. And if you mess with it, you violate it, you twist it, usually somewhere along the lines, people get hurt. And in our families, there are areas that we can do much more for introspection. The gentleman brought up the idea that everyone should go to college. Well, where is that working? Now, for many of us are college educated, and we don't have any problems with that, but have you seen the cost of tuition lately? I remember, just for my own self, going to Concordia, Wisconsin, emerging with a huge amount of debt, and at the time, I thought I was going to be a pastor. In other words, I would still be paying off that debt. The amount of the debt is not proportional to the kind of curriculum you get. Well, what does that have to do with family? Well, remember what I mentioned about money problems? So if we're counseling young people into, this is just my gateway into this, there's lots of different gateways, home mortgage, credit card, you know, lots of different ways one can get bound up in all this. And we want to help people have strong families. We want to strengthen our own family. We'll look at something that American society just takes for granted. You go to college, get in debt. I already talked about this, right? Get the mortgage, and then by the time you're 60, 65, hopefully you have it paid off, start getting a pension. That's kind of the American way. That's not necessarily a good way to live out God's plan on this planet with our families. Those things tend to tug at it. Other examples. I promised Peggy that I would bring this up. Where's Peggy? Yeah. Because I mentioned something that she chastised me when I talked about. It was a very stern review. I mentioned even something as similar to the distance that we live from our families, our social network of our families. I mean, I grew up in the Detroit area. As soon as I hit 18, man, I was gone. You know, here I am. And I still think that was the right move, because have you seen Detroit? But in general, ultimately, realize that for our family to have the kind of installation needed in order to persevere, we did need to be around family, grandparents, aunts and uncles, that sort of thing. Something as simple as the automobile has made it possible now to live anywhere. You can work an hour away from your job, and you just take it for granted. This is the way it is. Trust me, I'm not trying to like live an hour away from work. I'm not trying to judge you. I'm trying to give you examples of things that you should bring under your evaluation, things to think about, not take for granted, and recognize that you might have to do certain things that will have a cost that must be paid. So if you know that you're going to be spending 2 hours extra a week just driving, then you might need, for your family's sake, you might intentionally think about how can I make this up in other ways. I'm saying that if you want to see the family grow and strengthen again, everything has to come back under our consideration and brought into obedience to the biblical worldview as God has revealed it. Because he knew what he was doing, as he made the universe, he made the earth, and he made us, and he's God. So, trust him, even on these other things. So, we would not be, we've got to talk about the spiritual dimension of it. A lot of the people we've talked about, I mean, I mentioned some names, you got Jaffa, Billiers, you know, these are individuals, but they also are under attack, right? Some of the things they did willingly on their own, but a lot of them were also manipulated by the enemy that haunts us all. And what I want to get across in the last few moments here is that we need to learn to think generationally. A lot of times, a lot of organizations will have like the 3-year plan, or the 5-year plan. I'm lucky to have a 1-month plan, personally. That's not the way these people work. If you look at their documents, their time frame for realizing their goals was the year 2000, just as an example. So they already saw out one generation. Now consider our enemy, Lucifer, his time frame. He's had thousands of years to study us, to know us better than possibly we know ourselves, to have a greater insight into all of the data, as it were. And he knows that from his point of view, he wants to create as much havoc, pain, and suffering as he possibly can, especially on the people of God. So, if we try to build our families, even if we build it on the rock of the scriptures, rock of Christ, absolutely, but forget, he is trying to undermine you at every move, you might make some very unfortunate blunders and have some things that you regret, and that, you know, blow off your, you know, temper, or, you know, say something, or do something. Tempted. You see where I'm going with this, right? You know, do something that you didn't think you could possibly ever do, and yet now you're doing it. Well, that's because you were under attack. And you forgot that there is an attack. There is someone who is fighting against us. So, next week, my goal is to sort of wrap all this up into this big sort of, okay, what can we do? And one of the core components to that I only mentioned, because I've talked about a great deal here, is to bring everything under obedience to the biblical worldview. But we're more likely to do that if you think the biblical worldview is actually true. And that's where Christian apologetics can be of service to you. So, final questions or comments. What do we have now?
We have about 9 minutes.
Okay.
And Tony, we're going to talk about the attack you had, the personal attack you had regarding your daughter.
Sure, yeah, all right.
Why don't you describe the personal attack that you experienced when it came to your daughter?
Are we talking about the doctor? Yeah, okay. Yeah, so this is actually kind of goes to the advocate for formation part to it. And the way that I got into all this, my mind started thinking in these directions was with my daughter. We had the boys, we went to the ultrasounds, and we begged the ultrasound guy to tell us that it was a girl. That was one. No offense to multiples or anything, but one at a time are preferable. And during the course of that ultrasound session, the technician guy got increasingly quiet and solemn, even maybe. And then when finally it was over, we went to the an office, and the doctor actually came in and just straight to the point, saying, you know, it looks like your daughter has hydrocephalus, which is this problem's kind of big. And then they set up a second level of ultrasound to get the confirmation. They were going to do the amniocentesis and do some more ultrasounds to try to confirm it for us. So we went to the second level. And after kind of a long search for the evidence of actual spinal bifida, it was confirmed. And within like that same moment of confirming that she had spinal bifida, he gave us the option of terminating her. I think that's the word he used. And just, so here we are in our grief, really. And all the dash expectations that we had, you know, just lying in rubble on the ground. And in that setting, we're being asked to make this life and death decision. We didn't hardly even know anything about spinal bifida. We only had about an hour and a half to consult one of the greatest sources of knowledge in the world, Google, to try to find out about spinal bifida. And that's not really enough. Not even close. We're still asking us this question. Well, we told the doctor it was just not an option. He never really bothered us about it. But that set me on a course. I wanted to know, how could a doctor put a question like that for us in a setting like that? How can that be considered respectable or decent? And I began to find out that there was a lot of people who believe, first of all, that suffering is the greatest evil. The only evil, really, this is the happiness versus suffering. And so to bring into a world a child who we know is going to suffer, that's bad. They have economic considerations. Well, what's this going to cost our healthcare system? They have all these disabled people around. And so they have a lot of reasons for trying to sort of get people to gently, voluntarily kind of see the light on this. And in fact, there was a whole medical field called genetic counseling that was established by people with, this is going to sound crazy, really, like, there's no way, specifically created by people who wanted to persuade parents like us to voluntarily terminate the child. It's called genetic counseling. And right when we finished, he sent us to the genetic counselor, who I had no idea had this kind of baggage, neurological baggage behind it. I mean, I didn't know at the time. And he's a nice guy. You know, even now, I don't even think he knows. You know. So, now let's unravel this a little bit. Why did we make the decision that we did? Well, we had a biblical worldview that we thought about in advance, not at the moment of crisis. It didn't require, you know, consulting journals and, you know, running around and asking our pastor, you know, what's the Bible say? We knew that the Bible valued life and that this was a life to be valued. So for us, even though the moment was difficult, the decision was easy. That's not the case for many people. And at this time, I did not know any of the stuff that I'm talking about right now. I was just sort of going around in my life, kind of willy-nilly, taking circumstances as they happen, not even thinking that I might have to make a life and death decision, you know, the next day, kind of a thing. No longer. Every moment is an opportunity, and every moment is a chance to proclaim the gospel to someone, and the fullest expression of that opportunity is the time that I have with my family. If anyone wants, I didn't come here to talk about that part of it, but it really is wrapped up in this. If you want to join me in that journey, please get some contact information. stay in touch, keep in touch on Facebook or whatever. I don't invest myself in politics. I think there's much bigger things in play, but I do recognize that it's someplace that we need to be involved in some level. So if you want to assist me in that, you know, welcome to involve. Questions, comments? 2 minutes, I believe, right? Because if you don't give me questions or comments, I will talk to you. And you don't want to. Right over there.
Just as a brother in Christ, we've heard about faith, we've talked about and heard about a biblical worldview. And maybe it seems obvious, but that requires reading the Bible, reading what God has to say, the Word of God, which is the Holy Spirit coming to you and I, to His people, to the world, with His will, with forgiveness, with calling us into account by the law and proclaiming the gospel to us. And we get into this, faith comes by hearing, in this biblical word worldview. Brothers and sisters in Christ, read God's word. For your families, for you, as you follow the Lord and as you lead under the Lord's leadership. This is why being in worship is so important, to be forgiven, blessed by word and sacrament, but also in your daily devotions and with your families and when you're talking with your kids and grandkids, read the Bible so that we all can be formed by Him. I would have a question about when did we take the Word of God out of the public schools? When did that all tie in? Because our children, you know, this gets back to who is the faith developers that the Lord uses in families, parents, and it comes through the Word of God.
Thank you. Well, 1960, the Supreme Court ruled that you couldn't have prayer at school. You would have to go back to a gentleman by the name of John Dewey. Some of you probably have heard that name. Prior to 1930 or so, the school systems in America were fairly safe and conciliatory. It was part of that culture. They used Bible verses in the curriculum. Sort of thing. John Dewey and others who were with him saw that the education system served as the perfect social engineering tool for a particular vision of a citizen. And at that point, then, this emphasis on public must be neutral kind of started coming in. And the problem is, it wasn't just implemented at the Supreme Court level, but people themselves had already started to get the idea that the separation of religion and state kind of thing meant that you were not allowed to be religious in public. And so the schools slowly themselves, just the people who were in them realized, just started not incorporating those things. And because John Dewey left such a big mark on the education system, you have to figure, and again, think generationally, he was 1900 to 1930 or so, and if you read his writings, you will be horrified at what this guy wanted to do. But that's not the stuff that's taught kids, the next teachers. So the teachers that John Dewey trained were the teachers of when? 60s and 70s. Those are the people who were teachers, and now the next generation of people who have been taught by them, so on and so forth. And C.S. Lewis actually saw that coming too. Can I wrap it up then? Or do you want to wrap it up? To bounce off of what you said, one of my key points is going to be that the amount of time and effort it takes to really know what you believe and why you believe it, the time that it takes to read the Bible for yourself, all the things that come up are hard to fit into our busy lifestyles. And that too is a trap, our busy lifestyles. And we have to start taking these things under our own control, under obedience. Because it's very important. No one can read the Bible for you. You can't. That's not the kind of thing that can be delegated. So it's going to be important. Everyone here is in a possible position of influence, either your mother or father, grandmother, grandfather, aunt, and uncle. And as you grow older, young people, you're going to have that opportunity to make those decisions. Just real quick, you know, I didn't know as a 35-year-old I would have a chance to make a life and death decision. But young people, like 17 or 18, are more likely to be able to influence those because people who are having abortions tend to be between 16 and 22. And young people will know more people like that than I will. So even there, you think, well, I can just wait till I'm out of college. I'll be able to, then I'll be the adult. Then I'll do the mature things. No, you might be critical now. It's be critical to be used by God in that way. You must first be used by Him and grow in His word. And a lot of this will be repeated next week. Thank you very much for your time and attention and having me.